Ladies and gentlemen, welcome back to Planet Tyro to continue our Ralph Bakshi retrospective. I am your host, as always, Donald Wonder, and I'm joined by my good buddy, the youngest boy in the whole world, the Catface Killer.
Hey!
And actually, I'm glad you used the hey, because that's going to be appropriate for one of the things we're going to be discussing later on in this recording.
The Fonz.
Yeah. Last time, guys, if you were following us on this Ralph Bakshi retrospective, we actually spoke about the first theatrical release of The Lord of the Rings. It was the animated rotoscoped version, which was quite impressive for the time, and actually it's aged pretty well. If you're watching on YouTube, I'll put a link in the top right hand corner, you'll see it in the YouTube card. But if you're listening on the podcast, audio only, I will put a link in the description and you can check out the whole filmography we've been covering for Mr. Ralph Bakshi. Anyway, guys, so on this discussion, we usually do one Bakshi movie at a time, but this time we're going to do two, because we're going to do American Pop and Hey Good Looking. Now, the reason why I'm going to throw Hey Good Looking at the end is just because, guys, I know I'm trying to be a completionist here, and I want to give everything its due time. Hey Good Looking, I'll go into this in a bit more detail when we get to it. It was a shelved movie. As a viewing experience, is extremely bad. Very, very bad. Even if we watched it and even if we gave its own video, even if we tried to mine for things to talk about, it would end up being a 10-minute conversation. So why waste our time making another video when it doesn't have to be? So I made the young boy just watch a couple of clips, because honestly, guys, that movie, just no. But before we get to that, let's go and talk about American Pop, which was made in 1981. Which is another animated rotoscoped movie, which is, this movie is a very, very good concept. And again, Ralph Bakshi coming off the heels of Lord of the Rings, I like him doing different things. We're past that street urban era where he's making those street community stories, and, you know, the fantasy thing was a good idea. And now he wants to try doing, speaking of retrospective, he wants to do somewhat of a retrospective of American music pop culture. And to do that, he ties it in with this fictional generational family story. And I'm going to ask Old Boy about this. But we always say one thing we love in animation, we want to see in animation more, are generational stories. Like one of the things we've talked about to ad nauseum, JoJo's Bizarre Adventure.
Yep, I was going to mention JoJo.
Yeah, we'll get to that in more detail. But this movie covers a series of family, four generations of family that are based off immigrants that came to America. I believe it was from Russia. And you see how each father and son basically pass the torch and how they evolve in each genre of music. And it just covers a whole lot of themes. We're going to get more into it, but that's just the general idea. It's just a legacy of a family and how they evolved through American pop culture of music. And I'm just going to come right out the gate, as always, and ask my buddy, how did you think of the movie? How was it for you?
Oh, this is something that's probably made for somebody like me. My name originally came from my love of older music and styles, fashion, and all this stuff, pop culture. Like, my favorite decade is the 50s, like the looks, the music, and everything. But I love, like, mobster jabs, which is in this movie. I like stuff from around the turn of the century, the 19th century being, or I mean the 20th century being the century I'm talking about.
Sure.
I like the roaring 20s swing and all that stuff, all these different decades of music that I like up until like the 60s, 70s, 80s, which is also included in the movie, is in this movie. So I mean, there's a lot for me to like, and it's not just the music, you know. It's like I said, you have the eras as well, because this is four generations. So you have each character, as the story is focused on them, it shows them growing up, you know, their childhood, their kind of middle-ish years as teenagers, and then like their adulthood, depending on how long they live, because, you know, if it's four generations, obviously people die. And I really enjoyed it, especially with my love of the music and the fashion and all the eras and the culture and stuff. If you're like me, this is probably like a low solid B, but for most people, I think this is probably going to be like an acquired taste. It's going to be neat. The animation especially is very fluid, because I think at this point, Bakshi had really kind of nailed down the rotoscoping, but the way it looks though, like the the drawings and the actual art quality, it actually kind of looks kind of bad for some reason. So, I mean, it's kind of a mixed bag. If it's your thing, it's your thing. If it's not, it'll be kind of a neat oddity.
Yeah, I completely agree. I mean, as the movie goes on and you get to the more, well, it stops in the 80s because that's when the movie was made, at the turn of the, it's just the beginning of the 80s. So as the movie gets into those times of, you know, punk and kind of disco stuff like that, which only touches upon a bit, the visuals get a little bit more mesmerizing, and as always he gets more experimental. So it's not just a rotoscope, and he does that thing where he even puts live action flashy images, negative colors, all that stuff with the music. And sometimes it fits specifically when they're having little music videos, especially. It gets very psychedelic, very trippy, and it works. My problem with the movie is Ralph Bakshi's got a better script this time, and we always say that the script is always what fails him, but he always has this thing that I don't enjoy, which is he lets you, scenes just go on. I mean, because they're four generations, you don't spend equal time with all of them. The pacing's okay, but sometimes I just felt scenes lingered on way too much, especially I think near the last one, where, you know, this particular couple that they just got addicted to drugs. That shit went on a little bit too long for me. And just bits and pieces that I was like, if this was a bit tighter and a little bit more focused, it would be great. But it wasn't as bad as his other ones because...
No, not nearly. I mean, like, even with all my love of the subject matter, like, if it was bad, you know me, I'm going to be like, no. And I would lambast this.
And to be honest with you, one of the most things I want to praise is that he doesn't go back in the time with any, like, what's the word I'm looking for? He's not trying to make things look better than they were. I mean, a lot of these characters are doing really messed up things. They're getting involved with crime. They're drug addicts. It doesn't put that glimmer of light on any of these periods. Like, I know when a lot of people do, you know, flashback movies or period pieces, you only focus on the great times. I mean, this is more like, I don't want to say it's more like something like Boardwalk Empire, but when it focuses on this era, it doesn't shy away from how it really was. And that's what Bakshi does. But sometimes in the past, he kind of goes too far with it and it becomes ridiculous in how the violence is over the top and the sex is over the top. But this time it felt like, you know, it was more balanced. It was a bit extreme at points, but it was like he reined himself in and he focused more on the music and what the characters were doing and how they were furthering their career. How they furthered their potential in each of their genres, in each of their lives. And I think my favorite story of all of these was probably the first one, which I think
with Zombie the immigrant.
No, the second one then, because that's when the guy's working
with Benny,
in the...
his son.
Yeah, that was the guy who was working in the burlesque as the clown. Is that right?
Yes.
Yeah, that was my favorite because I just connected with that story the most, just because the guy was a bit of an underdog and, you know, he went overseas to do that performance and he got shot in the throat and his voice really became hoarse. And that was really, I found the story very connective. And I guess I liked the very last one as well, but that was a bit more weird for me. But the first one was a lot more what I'm used to in this kind of tale. Again, we saw him from his youth to his growth. It was a lot more complete, and they spent a lot of time on that story, but that was the one I liked the most. The rest were okay, but for me, that was the one I liked personally the most out of the four.
Yeah, I probably liked his tale the most, but only because I love stories, and he had the most complete story. That was actually Zalmi, the first one, the immigrant. He was in the burlesque show. His son was the pianist who went to war. He had, the shortest story.
Yeah, that's it. Thank you. That's my correct. Yeah. Thanks for correcting me there, yeah.
Benny's son was a songwriter. He actually had no musical talent, but he had a way with words. And he had his story was decently lengthy. And then his son was very... I felt like it was really quick at the end. But I liked it all in all, like... Probably up there with Lord of the Rings for me, but like I said, this caters to me specifically in my tastes and my interests. So the average person probably not gonna like it too much, but if these are your things, then I would check this out. Like, if you were to ask me what things of Ralph Bakshi would you recommend checking out, I'd be like, well, if you want to be offended, then check out Coonskin. If you love older eras of music and American pop culture, this definitely, like, I I can't think of many other examples that are really good about that. And like you said, it's not like an extreme. Like when we talk about like Boardwalk Empire, for example, that's like extreme negative. And like a lot of the other stuff is extreme positive. This is just how it is. Like Baxi doesn't go nuts for once. He actually is like, this is how it is. Like, it's just neutral.
Yeah.
Then there was also Lord of the Rings, obviously. So, like, those are the only things out of all of Baxi's filmography at this point I would recommend to anybody for those reasons.
Let me tell you, man, it's funny you said that, oh, this is catered towards someone like you, because there's a lot of people in the music industry that think this is an epic masterpiece. And I can understand, because at the time, and actually to this very day, no one's actually done this kind of musical retrospective in an animated form, and it's very, very inspired. I mean, this is one of the most creative things Baxi's done. It's a very good idea, and it's a combination of good idea, good execution, really good storytelling, and it's still unique to this very day. And again, because music is such an artistic creation, an artistic medium, from conception to actual the music, listening to the music, to visually with the music videos, and Baxi incorporates most of that. And to this day, I thought, this is really fucking awesome. And I'm really surprised that to this day, no one's really touching it. Now, they have said that Kanye West paid homage to this. When Kanye West made that auto-tune album called 808s and Heartache, which everyone lambosted him about, even South Park made an episode about him where they was running him singing with the fish. That was really funny. The Kanye West music video had a part where they use backgrounds of this particular movie, again using the rotoscoping, because actually I think that whole movie was, that whole music video, Kanye West, was rotoscoped as well, and he even paid homage to Ralph Bakshi for that. So this movie stands as its own, as a testament to his love for music being unique. And again, a lot of people in the industry think this is a very epic love letter to music. And the only thing that could have made this better is if Ralph Bakshi made this in the 90s, because then he would have caught, you know, the movie catches on to the point from, like, obviously the early 20th century to the 80s. But obviously, if we got to the 90s and 2000s, then us, we could have appreciated it even more, because he probably would have got a rap in there, early rap and stuff like that. But I don't know, maybe he wouldn't have, because it was a white family. But I'm just saying, he would have got more genres in there. But either way, I'm kind of surprised that no one else picked this idea up and did it again, especially in the form of music videos, because music videos are so creative. We've seen so many animated weird music videos, you know, like the Daft Punk thing to some other different artists. I would just think, wow, man, someone should really do this again. And again, Kanye West is the only one that really, according to Wikipedia, was the only one that really did something with this idea. And yeah, it's remembered very fondly for Baxi doing that. And lastly, one thing we didn't mention, I'm sorry to cut you, but I don't want to forget, the voice acting is very good in this movie. The voice acting was done very well.
Oh, yeah, that's right. Like I said, you know, it's on the same level as Lord of the Rings. Voice acting is professional for once. I actually really enjoyed it. That's probably what helped me get immersed into the story as well. You got to give it to Baxi. Like, the guy is brave. He has chops. Clearly, nobody else has tried something like this. Like you said, I think a lot of people get hung up on the idea, like, I have to have a protagonist, and my everything revolves around this protagonist. That's how people write stories and stuff. They're afraid to let go of protagonists. To me, a protagonist is a tool. Like, you can throw away your protagonist, and if you don't have a story anymore, if it wasn't a character piece, you didn't have a good story, probably. So I think Baxi maybe subconsciously understands this, or maybe he didn't care at all. He just wanted to highlight music and different pop culture eras of America. But I think it's not done as often, because it's a real gamble to do that. Like especially when it comes to money being involved. Like, if you fuck up, then you just torpedoed your whole franchise because you threw away your protagonist. You know what I mean?
I do. And actually, I don't want to derail you, but since you brought it up, that's something I want to have a little mini discussion with you about, because we've spoken about this on JoJo's Adventure as well, about how, why don't more storytellers use this whole family tree, this generational storytelling. And I always have my thought that, you know, whenever I've spoken to people that have gone to screenwriting school or had to write a story, they always say there's like three types of story. And, you know, if you go against the norm, general audiences just don't understand it. And what I mean by that is, maybe general audiences are only used to seeing one protagonist and one story. And if you try to throw too much at them, it just doesn't work for the most part. So, you know, to be successful, you got to stick to the more tried and true. And that's why I reckon we only see, well, I don't want to say I reckon, because again, I don't want to generalize and make audiences feel like they're so dumb, because the few people that I have seen that have tried generational stories, which are very, 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 very few at this point, I seem to like them. And they are very different. So I don't really know why to this day they're so few and far between. I understand in the movie it can be disorientating, throwing so many characters at you. But if the rule is, for the most part, just throw one character, I would think that someone would want to try to mix it up, or there'll be a whole bunch of people that will try to mix it up by throwing more generational stories. But it seems like it's such a taboo. It's such a taboo. You don't do it. You don't do it. It's just so risky that... That's why we only end up with the few that are really out there. So it's kind of sad to me.
It's sad to me too. Like, my favorite stories, Lord of the Ring is actually multi-generational, because you go from Bilbo to Frodo.
Yes, exactly.
Technically, Game of Thrones is multi-generational because, spoiler alert, oh my God, Eddard dies. And from that point on, you're following the rest of his family. True. Spoiler alert again, they continuously die. So, like, all the protagonists keep dying and you switch, technically moving to a new generation.
It's funny you say that, because I have spoke about making a prequel to Game of Thrones when it ends anyway, to the whole, even before the proper Westeros era, before, there's so much, it's such an epic story, they can, just like they did with Lord of the Rings, exactly, they can go back and tell the pre-story. So, yeah. I wouldn't be surprised.
To be honest, I would like to see that if it was Eddard's story, because, like, that was my favorite character still. To this point in the story, that's still my favorite character. And when I get flashbacks of when you actually see what the truth was of the past, and I see more of his character, I like the character more. So, I actually would like to see that story told, but, I mean, like... At this point, I wonder how the rest of the fan base feels. They're probably fatigued, because it's a very long story.
Yeah, I would like to have a deeper discussion with you about it, but we got to move on, because, I don't want to...
We're getting sidetracked.
Yeah, we're going to stay on topic, and let's just wrap this up. So, going on IMDb and Rotten Tomatoes, again, this has got above average scores. The reviews are very favorable, because, again, this is such a special movie. It pays homage to music, which, again... It hits so many genres. Of course, you're gonna hit the fan base on this, for people like yourself, which you said is geared towards me. I like it. And again, he's just getting better and better. I feel like all the things I don't like about Bakshi, he seems to be reining himself in, and his story ideas are getting more creative, more mature, and just more likable. So this movie is a win. I think this is a very good movie. I can only say this from my personal experience. I don't love all the type of music here. I love the early 30s to 40s stuff. When it got to the end with the punk and the rock, I was like, not my thing. But visually, I like what he did with that. So, But anyway, good movie. I would definitely recommend it. And I didn't give my rating. I would give it a low solid B. That's me personally. It's above average. It's a bit dated, as it would be for what, 34 years now. But definitely check it out. So, we're going to move on to the next movie, which, again, I'm just going to add on here because, guys, let's talk about Hey There, Good Looking.
I'm going to come out and say I didn't watch this, and I was actually looking forward to this the most because of how it looked and what it's centered on. And then you're like, no.
Well, it's ironic. Don't bother. You just said on the previous discussion just a moment ago that you like the 50s, and this movie is set in the 50s. It's a flashback movie. The movie starts in present modern day, which at the time was 1982, I believe. Yeah. No, actually, it was 1975, which... I had to correct myself, and I'll get to why in a moment. But the movie goes back 25 years and tells a story about this guy named, is it Vinny? Very typical 50s kind of name, Vinny.
Vinny.
And he runs a gang called the Clubbers or whatever? And basically, it's just about, it's a kind of a slice of life, Vinny in the 50s. He wears, I'm being a bit particular here. One of the funniest bits of the movie is when it starts, when we go back into the 50s, not when it starts, you see Vinny putting on his leather jacket with about 7 different zips. It's so ridiculous. And that's the problem with this movie. To my surprise, man, it is such a Looney Tunes cartoon. Let's go all the way back to Coonskin and Heavy Traffic. I said those are Looney Tunes cartoons as well, especially Heavy Traffic with, that guy who's an animator and all these weird characters around him. I thought that was wacky. This is more wacky than that. But the difference with this movie is that it's animated better. The character designs are a lot better in this movie, but it's such an immature and silly movie. it is a coming of age story. It's just about this gang, this guy's in the gang, and you know, kind of like Grease, you've got the boys and the girls and very kind of similar, but he's running this gang. He sees this girl. Well, he doesn't even know it's a girl. He starts beating up this little boy. He's like, oh, what are you doing on my turf or whatever? And turns out to be one of his young old school friends who's a girl. And obviously he punches her out of her overcoat. And you can see that she's this voluptuous, gorgeous brunette who's so... She's got the breasts and the ass, and honestly, she's the best thing, not just visually. She's the best thing about the movie, mostly visually, actually, to be honest with you. And it's just about their kind of budding love relationship and him getting into gang trouble. That's it. That's all the movie's about. And the reason why this movie's so frustrating, it's just so silly and immature. They have all these silly gags, and that's basically it. There's no real story. The movie tail ends on something that is very... That doesn't work, but for 90% of the movie, it's just Vinny and his gang and all these silly jokes, all these silly offensive jokes as well. Sexually offensive.
I was going to say, like, one of the only things I saw is he was faced off with a black gang. He's like, it's my job to know where you are all the time. And the guy's like, yeah, where was I last night? And he just looks at him, he's like, watermelon. I was like, oh my God.
He said eating watermelon.
eating watermelon. I'm sorry, eating watermelon. It's like, oh my God, that's so fucking offensive.
It is. Well, don't get me wrong. It was funny because he's asking for... He's a dickhead. The guy's an asshole. That's the one thing about Vinny.
They're both dickheads.
Yeah, he's an asshole. So they're just getting into gang wars. And there's lines like that throughout the movie. He's fucking horny as hell. I mean, let me just kind of paint a picture for you guys that might even be interested. This movie is kind of like Looney Tunes mixed with Johnny Bravo, mixed with Heavy Traffic. That's it. I know most.
I mean, like, I like two of the three of those things, so where's the hang up?
Well, if you mix Johnny Bravo, just take Johnny Bravo with Heavy Traffic. Those two things is exactly what it is. Johnny Bravo was that, obviously, it was a light comedy cartoon, right? If that cartoon was airing today, it would be seen as completely sexist, by the way, even by its light standards. But Johnny Bravo, he loves women. He's always coming onto them in a very light and comical way, but he's chauvinistic, but in a very, very light-hearted way. Now, if you mix that element with Heavy Traffic, where Backstreet's going balls to the wall and overtly a sexist and violent, then you've got this movie, you know. But you add the Happy Days 50, have to have Happy Days Grease feel to it, and that's basically it. And honestly, the movie is a fucking chore. It goes around in circles. It's just a series of Looney Tunes gags, and I was just so frustrated with a movie like Backstreet. How could you go 25 steps back after all the things you've learned? And that's where I have to go behind the scenes with the movie, because it turns out this movie was actually made, I believe, right after Coonskin.
Yep.
Which fits in perfectly with the train of thought, the kind of things that he was doing at the time, his crazy urban stories. But this was a flashback one. And what happened was, this was actually meant to be, well, correct me if I'm wrong, people, but I checked on Wikipedia, but this was meant to be a Roger Rabbit style movie where it was meant to be animation mixed with live action. And Warner Brothers saw this, like, this isn't going to work. And they shelved it. Then what happened was, Ralph actually became so good at rotoscoping, they were like, oh, actually, why don't you rotoscope those live action moments, animate over the live action moments, and then we'll release it. So they shelved it from 1975 to 1982. And then they released it with the rotoscoping. That's why you can see a lot of rotoscoping in this movie, which Ralph actually does well. There's a breakdancing scene, which again we spoke about off mic, which was very cool to watch. And apparently it's one of the first breakdancing scenes ever filmed, because it was filmed in 1975. But again, since it came out in 82, it's too late. But the movie tail ends on this kind of weird thing where Vinny and this girl, I forgot her name. I think it's Roz. Vinny and Roz, they were all throughout the movie trying to get together, and there was even a scene where he was just pressing her pressing her breast and going honk, 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 honk. And it's just a stupid scene. Anyway, they have this budding relationship, but they don't end up together. And at the beginning of the movie, you find out that actually it didn't work out between them two, and that she's working at the bar, at some stripper bar, and he comes in and he's washed up. And at the end of the movie, it flash forwards to that, where they finally meet up, where their lives are completely kind of ruined, and she's big and fat, and she's doesn't look anything like how she was before, and he looks like a fucking alien. So basically, again, the movie was kind of incoherent. So it's like the movie was trying to say that they didn't work out in their youth, but at the end, they get together and they're not who they used to be, but she was always waiting for Vinny to come back, blah blah blah. And by the end, I was like, what the fuck was this? I was like, really? The movie is trash. 100% trash. It's a waste of time. And all the complaints I made about the previous Rough Backstreet movies, there was something there. They were incoherent, like Heavy Traffic and Coonskin. They bothered me, but this movie is worse than them. It's just a rambling Looney Tunes mess. It's just not funny and there's nothing going on. I mean, it's a tie with Coonskin. They're pretty, I'm giving Coonskin a little bit too much leeway. Coonskin is more offensive, obviously, but this one is just as a big of a waste of time. So guys, do not watch this movie. You can watch clips on YouTube, but it's just so silly. Oh, and lastly, man, the music is so obnoxious. They're doing this, obviously, that big part of the movie is the music. Hey, Good Looking, I believe, was a single. Hey, Good Looking, it plays when the movie starts. And all the movie's hitting you with the 50s music, but it's forced in. It's loud. It's over the characters' voices. It's very disjointed and jarring, and it's just forcibly in there to let you know that you're in the 50s, you're in the 50s, hear the music. With all the stupid jokes, there was no way I could let my buddy, I could not subject my buddy, the young boy, to this. It's just a waste of time. And again, go on IMDb, go on Rotten Tomatoes. Like Ralph Becci's other movies, it's got cult halo around it, but in terms of how it's aged horribly. And I believe to this day it's not on DVD. So take that for what it's worth.
Hey, you know what? There's always going to be a cult following for anything. Have you ever heard of Ankle Biters? Terrible fucking movie. Like, I don't even know how this guy managed to get the money to make this movie back in, like, I think the 80s or whatever. So there's always going to be people who are like, no, it's great.
Yeah, of course.
Don't worry about that. But I'm glad you spared me from that. Because like I said, my favorite era of pop culture in American history. And it's probably be like bashing me over the head with a spike club.
You would have told me, I can't finish this, Don. You would have actually, you said it in the past before, I just can't. You would not, even for this retrospective, you would have told me, I can't do it. Because honestly, nothing happens. It just, this movie just stops and goes round in circles to such a degree, I just couldn't do it. And it was a slog to watch. So guys, if you hate my opinion, you think I'm completely wrong, let me know in the comments down below. Again, it's not about agreeing, that's just my perspective. And I don't know, man, this was a bad movie. And I honestly think it kind of taints his filmography at this point, because he's on the upscale. And even on the next movie we're going to talk about, again, I felt that he's continued to rise. So releasing this movie did nothing but kind of sour his filmography at this point. But it does make me forgiving, knowing that he did not make this movie at this point in his career. They bought this movie out of the vault, where they should have left it the fuck back in.
Yeah, they should have left that ring in the volcanoes of Mordor.
Exactly. So guys, this was a 2-for-1. I think we spent longer on this, my little rant on this one, than American Pop. But guys, hey, I like your feedback. I love what you got to say. If you've seen these two movies or any other Ralph Bakshi movies, leave us a comment on any of the videos or this one. Let us know in the comments down below. Young boy.
Yes.
Let me thank you for coming on this one, as always.
Yeah, I mean, I guess I did less work than normal, so yay!
We still got a ways to go, though. We got a few more, and I have to say, at least those ones, we won't be skimming over. We're going to complete those ones, except for the very last one, which is half an hour, which will lump with Cool World. But anyway, guys, don't worry about that. Again, I'll put a link in the top right corner to listen to the other videos we've done. Give us a thumbs up on the video if you like it. Comment down below. As always, subscribe to the channel if you haven't already. We want more people on Planet Tyro. And until the next one, we'll say thanks for listening, and we'll see you later.
Smell you later.